This image is a recent composite from the James Webb Telescope and the Atacama Large Millimeter Array, and I think it is a good argument for the role of electricity in the formation of solar systems. Pascucci et al. Just published the data and the analysis. This image looks like a young solar system, a disk of material with hints of orbits that might be planets. Out of the top and the bottom of this disk are jets of energy and matter. A close-up of the jet. The blue line in the center is from iron. The green line around it is from hydrogen. Iron in the center and hydrogen surrounding is what would naturally happen if strong electric currents were forming the baby solar system. I will lay out that argument, and then I will explain why a grain of salt is needed. Marklund Convection. The idea developed by Göran Marklund in 1979 is that electric current will flow through space and it will naturally cause a segregation of elements and compounds. Elements such as iron, while they are moving along, will go towards the center of the current, while elements such as hydrogen and helium will migrate to the outside. The segregation depends upon the ionization energy. If you more easily lose an electron, you end up in the center.
Here are a couple of excellent programs on Marklund convection.
Heavy elements like iron will more easily lose an electron and hence become positively charged. This ease of becoming positive makes these atoms more susceptible to the Lorentz force, hence bringing those ions more towards the center of the current because of their interaction with the magnetic field of the current. Elements like hydrogen and helium are less likely to become ionized, hence fewer of them will feel the inward pull, and they will segregate to the outside. You can work all this out if you are willing to learn the famous right-hand rule of electromagnetism, but it will require you spinning your hands around in public, pointing at nothing. I will point out that when a physicist works through all this, two mysteries must be invoked. Mystery number one, a current flow produces a magnetic field that circles around the line of the current. Mystery number two, a charged particle moving in a magnetic field will experience a force that is perpendicular to both its own motion and the magnetic field. In classical physics, there's no explanation for these two mysteries. They are observed and then formalized into Maxwell's equations and the Lorentz force, which correspond to items number one and number two. These two mysteries are handled much better in the electrodynamics formulated by Weber and Hertz. But as you know, the big guns come out if you make a peep against Maxwell. So I will let my audience explore the works of Thomas Phipps Jr. and André Koch Torres Assis to see for yourself why Maxwell's dynamics and the Lorentzian-Einstein relativity that results from it leave much to be desired. I have dived into those waters and swam back to shore quite breathless. I know now that Weber and Hertz and Phipps and Assis are more correct than Maxwell, but I'm not strong enough to jump in and save anyone else who dares to go into those waters. Getting back to the image from the recent Pascucci paper, we know that when electric currents flow through space, there will be a natural segregation of elements. Heavier elements such as iron will migrate to the center, lighter elements such as hydrogen will migrate to the outside, and they will form layers. This is observed in the Pascucci paper. It is what they have published. Now, that red outer layer is from carbon monoxide. Carbon monoxide has a slightly lower ionization energy than hydrogen, so you might wonder why it would be outside the hydrogen. But Marklund only calculated for atoms. Carbon monoxide has electric dipole and magnetic susceptibility that would need to be factored in, so I'm willing to let that slide for now. Pascucci et al., of course, are not advocating an electric model of solar formation. They are advocating a gravity model with magnetic fields that are a consequence of gravity. How does the gravity model predict the observed segregation? Short answer is it does not. You can examine their model of various thermal and magnetic winds and see if you find it satisfying. I got a little lost. I worked for a while with Richard Lovelace at Cornell Astrophysics, exploring the difference between the gravity model and electric model for star formation. He was delightfully tolerant of the electrical model. I only have good things to say about him. His gravity model went something like this. Gravity causes dust and gas to compress, and there is some amount of angular momentum initially in the system. That's two adjustable parameters. The compressing gas releases some energy through friction with itself. That was another four parameters. The ions and electrons each have their own temperatures, which can lead to a net current flow. I think this was six additional parameters. Magnetohydrodynamic models allow for a solution where a vortex of magnetic flux flows out perpendicular to the disk rotation, which drags away particles and angular momentum. I never understood this part, though it easily involved another four adjustable parameters. All this was played out in computer simulations. The code was years old from many graduate student lives of contribution. There was nothing in the model that addressed different elements being radially segregated. The model had many adjustable parameters, which might be chosen in ways that are physically meaningful, or might be chosen in ways that will give you the answer you want. Professor Lovelace is great, so no complaints there. But I knew I would never spend enough time to dig into the model, the gravity model, and the code to form any clear opinion of it for myself. So I left it and went back to the electrical models. As some of you know, using gravity to explain disk collapse is very tricky. If you imagine the dust falling in to some center, then the dust will just spin faster as the radius decreases, which will stop it from collapsing. But if enough did somehow compress to make a star, then stellar ignition will blast away any forming planets. So the gravity model has some pretty basic problems. Many of you have probably seen Pierre-Marie Robitaille's work where he explains that gravity collapse is impossible. There's a lot of math in all of this on both sides of the arguments, and I do weary from mathematicians telling nature what she can and cannot do. To summarize, the electrical model immediately predicts that you will see iron in the center of the jet with hydrogen on the outside. The gravity model is still struggling to explain this, let alone predict it. Hence, I say that the recent observations are a major win for the electrical model. So what about this grain of salt? Well, the grain is that we don't actually know what these objects are. We imagine they are young solar systems, and some of them probably are, but others might be something else. Something else entirely, which we do not yet have a name or a category for. The image above is taken by Hubble, though I can hardly believe it's raw data. It looks too much like an artist's fancy. That fine jet of plasma shoots for many billions of miles, and it does not widen even a fraction of a degree. Do you think magnetohydrodynamics predicts that? Do all solar systems form this way? Seems not. Why do these objects form this way? Well, that's unclear. These objects are all dubbed protostellar disks. And when I hear the word proto, I think two things. One, you have already decided that there are only stars out there and there's nothing else. Two, people use the preface proto when they do not know what they're talking about. My grain of salt has to do with assuming we know what the objects are. Whatever these objects are, it sure looks like some of them have a strong electric current flow and the resulting segregation of elements.
Some of these objects might be gestating solar systems. And some of them just might be something else. Thank you.